And it's super inspiring to see. It's like, it gets you excited. You know, we've got new bits coming.
So to outline the steps when bringing an upgrade to the circuit, you've obviously got to put together a bit of a plan as to what things you're going to work on. As a simple rule of thumb, the bigger the bit you're trying to change, the longer it's going to take to make. Equally, is the part you're making quite a critical structural part? And I'm sure for most teams, the front and rear wings are highly structural components. They're highly loaded. They have to be subjected to various tests that are performed on them to meet the regulations. And so those components tend to get defined quite early. Then you'd be looking at something like the floor and the main diffuser. That's, again, can be quite a long lead time item. And then you get into the bits that actually probably bring a lot more of the performance around, sort of bits around brake ducts and barge boards and maybe even engine covers and those things. They're a bit quicker to make, so we'd be doing those last. It's also important to understand is that the parts that get brought to the car and the parts that ultimately seen and we'll look at, it's worth remembering that they are just the sort of tip of the iceberg of solutions and things that were tried in the development. And so what you actually see is only one of maybe 1,000 different solutions that were firstly tried in CFD, and then that was whittled down to a number of solutions that would have been tried in the wind tunnel, and then only one of those solutions persists through to the circuit as the best option. We've done a lot of testing before they go to the circuit, but you never can fully replicate what you see on the circuit, so we also need to make sure those components will survive. And when choosing an upgrade, you're going to focus on those areas where you think you're going to get the most performance as quickly as possible. And I think that's always going to be the strategy a team takes, because it's about the kind of the area under the curve. It's how fast can you be as quickly as possible makes the differences. It's no good doing an amazing upgrade for the last race of the year, having done nothing all year, that puts you 1 second faster than all your competitors if you've spent all year being slower than them. Equally, if you upgrade in tiny little steps all year, you never make a big step forward. So it's always a balance between where you go looking and how big a project you take on. It's worth mentioning that lots and lots of options have been tried. Every little detail you see, you know, 100 brothers and sisters that went with it to try and make that exact change work. And there is a numerous amounts of people involved, hours and hours and hours of work involved in making those little details and perfecting those designs. And it's surprising, you know, when you hear people say, oh, you've only done that one version, because that's what the upgrade was. Of course, for us, it's obvious that there's sort of hundreds and thousands of versions behind that, and none of those are ever seen, and we learn a lot from the ones that don't work, and that's how we get better and ultimately come up with solutions that do work that we bring to the track.
The first time you get on the track, it's really difficult to feel the car being really different. It's just that you end up just going faster. So you get an upgrade and you have a few points of more front downforce, for example. It could almost be the same as adding front wing. It can be disguised in the balance. The areas that you do often notice is if the rear is more stable. So if you get more rear downforce, that's often the one that you will perhaps notice the most. And most often you get an upgrade going to a different track. It's hard to feel straight away that something they've added to the car. So it's not always easy to feel it. Well, there's a huge amount of work that goes into it. So much detail, so much design, and the build process. It depends how big an upgrade it is. We sometimes get upgrades that are a tenth of a second, sometimes they are, you know, a few tenths of a second.
So upgrades on the car tend to be both external, which, you know, we can see on TV, be it aero parts, and also internal. It could be an engine or a gearbox or a cooling system. And what we find often is little small things we can do. Again, I think that's probably quite a similar philosophy. A lot of the teams, they find little bits that are quite easy to implement, which we bring in between our main upgrades. The most interesting area for upgrades is the engine. All the action happens in the combustion chambers. It can be quite frustrating as a fan to say that, you know, there's a new engine coming for a team and they're expecting a performance step, but really it just looks exactly the same as the old one. And the engineers that worked on it know that there's 30-40% of the parts are all new and it's all different. But of course, outwardly it looks the same. So it's always quite interesting when you get some new innovation. Last year we ran the DAS steering system that we developed. That was only made visible by the fact that the drivers were moving the steering wheel backwards and forwards, and caused quite a sensation. There was quite a lot of interest in that. And it's good in a way that the drivers were doing something different with the steering wheel, because it really brought to life something that, to be honest, was completely invisible to anyone from the outside world. There's lots of little things like that on all these cars that the teams protect, really, really protect, to make sure that their main competitors don't find out. you do have a failed upgrade, all is not lost, because there is also the opportunity to learn a lot from that. And if you take the opportunity to understand why something hasn't worked, then what would seem like a failure can actually be turned quite quickly into success, and you'll see value in the future on subsequent upgrades. So, you know, when something's taken off and feels like a failure, that we always find a way generally to turn that back into a success at some point.
We're told them what things we're testing and the reasons for those things and the feedback that we're going to need and how important the run plan is in order to get the feedback on those components. So I'm very much in the loop where we're designing, where we're going, things that are coming. We're told every weekend what new parts we may or may not have. We've discovered it's more important quality over quantity. Yeah, it must have been a couple of years ago now, maybe 2019. A huge amount of work, you know, hundreds and hundreds of hours went into bringing in an upgrade package, and I think it was supposed to be around 3/10, and it didn't work. We couldn't figure out why. Upgrades don't always work. Correlation between the wind tunnel and real life is really, really difficult to get accurate. And it took us a lot of work to find a way. There's a different configuration the car needed in order for that to work. And then they had to reconfigure what was on the wind tunnel. And eventually we got the performance out, but it's not as easy as just putting a wing on and just going faster, because all these different elements interact with other elements.
There are four challenges to upgrading the car in 2021. The first one is the homologation rules, which limit the parts of the cars that we can change. The second one is the aero testing restrictions. So those restrictions become more severe the quicker the car you had last year. We're also in the position of having been the team that won last year's championship. We have the fewest runs in CFD, the fewest runs in the wind tunnel, and that's something else we've got to factor in. The third one is the cost cap. So obviously under a cost cap, we've got to think carefully about what we're doing. And the final one is balancing the 21 car with the 22 car, which is a huge regulation change. A set of regulation changes that are not only different in the car we're going to end up with, but also completely different in the way the rules are written. And that's a huge amount of work to get through. As a result of that, we're going to have to make really careful decisions about how much resource we spend on this year's car versus how much resource we spend on next year's car. COVID last year meant that the new rules that were coming for 21 were pushed back to 22. And in order to try and save costs, the teams agreed to freeze parts of the car or to homologate bits of the car. So all we were really left with that we could change from last year to this year was 2 tokens worth of structural bits plus aerodynamic changes. On top of this, the PU regulations were changed such that the PU could be upgraded once. And once it was upgraded, the only changes we could then make were for structural reasons, for reliability reasons. So as a consequence of that, that meant that we needed to get the car right for race one, and then all that we could do from there was really upgrade aerodynamic bits. We already know that some of our competitors will have changed their focus to next year, and they will have done that some time ago. They'll have given up on this year's championship and they'll put all their focus into next year. So we really need to think strategically about how we bring those upgrades and when we should bring them. It's not different to what we've done in the past, it's just even harder.
When you go to the factory and you see everyone at their workstations, head down, focused, determined, driven, people staying overtime to get projects finished, and you see these CAD drawings, or it could just be an idea and then it comes up in a CAD drawing and then becomes an actual physical piece. It's mind-blowing to see the creative genius of all these individuals. And it's super inspiring to see it. It's like, it gets you excited. You know, we've got new bits coming, or there might be something that we've wanted for time for, but it just takes like months to build. And when you finally get it and you put it to the car and it's something that you feel like more engine power in the low speed as opposed to high or something like that, you know, it's amazing.